Any movement to start that's going to move anywhere, it's got to get music to drive it.
Class isn't over. It's just begun.
You see the evidence of institutions, political institutions, breaking down. We've never seen that kind of thing happen. We see economic system falling apart. Okay, you could say it fell apart before in the Great Depression, okay, but never like this before. In Europe, in all parts of the world, we see it falling apart. All the things that have been going on for the past 6,000 years are finished now. It's a new time for it.
This is the Agent Clark Show.
Welcome back to the Angel Clark Show. It is Thursday. You know what that means. Every Thursday here on the show, we are joined by a liberty-oriented person for an episode that we like to call the Liberty Train. Choo-choo! And tonight is no different. Tonight, we are joined by Lyn Ulbricht, who is the mother of Ross, the man accused of creating and running the Silk Road website. He faces trial in November when those allegations must be proven. Now, the Silk Road is an anonymous, consumer-driven marketplace with very few restrictions on items that are bought and sold. What is not allowed is anything that is intended to harm or defraud, such as child pornography, assassinations, or weapons. And the only currency accepted is Bitcoin. Although Ross is in prison, accused of running it, the Silk Road operates and thrives today. Now, Lyn has no private information about the case, and she is not a lawyer, but she is in close communication with Ross and his attorney, Joshua Dratel, and Lyn has learned how the outcome of this case could set precedent and how it could influence new laws and how it could impact our freedom and the future of the internet. So, Lyn, I want to thank you so much for joining me this evening. I have to tell you that from the stories that I have heard regarding everything you're going through, you are one of the bravest women that I think I've ever spoken to.
Oh, that's really kind of you to say. I besides the fact that I love my son and I am sure that he's being accused of things he didn't do, and he is definitely a person worth fighting for. This is a big case. I've come to realize it's much more than a personal mission here. Some very important precedent will very likely be set with this case that's going to impact all of us. And I'm trying to get that word out because the lawyers all say it, not just our lawyer, but lawyers on blogs on the internet. And I think it's fairly apparent that because none of these things have been addressed in the courts before, that it will definitely set precedent about the internet and Bitcoin and digital currency.
Yes, absolutely. Now, first, there is the website freeross.org that our listeners should go to. You can also follow them on Twitter. The Twitter handle is free_Ross, and you can go to the Facebook fan page Free Ross as well. And there you can stay in touch with Lyn and keep in touch with everything that's happening. So, Lyn, let's talk a little bit about some of the precedents that we're talking about here, because on the website freeross.org, the first thing I see on this website when I go to it, internet freedom and privacy are at stake. The outcome of this case will impact your life. So it says the outcome of this case will impact your life. And I think that a lot of people don't understand just how much it will impact their life.
Well, I should have said if you use the internet.
Well, we all use the internet.
Forbes recently had an article talking about how the precedent set here could put a chill on the internet and commerce. And basically, what the prosecution is relying very heavily on in this case is something called transferred intent, which makes one person responsible for the intention and action of another person, specifically a website host responsible for the actions and intentions of accusers.
Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute, because I've heard of this type of thing before, right? In fact, there are other people that have Bitcoin charges being pressed against them right now, where they're saying that Charlie Shrem, I believe, is on house arrest and he's awaiting a trial, and they're saying that because he sold Bitcoin to someone who had the intent to use it for illegal purposes, he's held responsible. Right? This is the same kind of premise.
That's transferred intent. Exactly. And, you know, you had mentioned it's kind of interesting that Federal Express now is having is being indicted for being responsible for what people send through their service. That's transferred intent.
Now, what's really interesting is that I have spoken to people who ship illegal substances using the United States Postal Service, and they overnight it, because then it doesn't go through all the machines and doesn't get sniffed by this or sniffed by that, right? But so they overnight stuff, they pay the $17, they overnight it, bam, the next day they're illegal substances, they're at the home of someone else, and you know what? No one seems to be holding USPS responsible.
Yeah, I'm just waiting, you know?
it's not going to happen, but...
Yeah. And so basically it creates a lot more criminals, the whole idea of transfer intent, because it's not only that I'm responsible for what I do, I'm responsible for what someone else does and intends. And actually what they're saying is that Ross, they're alleging, was in conspiracy with even the ultimate user of a product. For example, there's a hacker charge. They're not alleging that Ross hacked into a computer or even agreed with somebody else to hack into a computer, or even that he sold or possessed software that could be used that way. They're just alleging that he provided a platform where someone else sold malicious software that might be used to hack into a computer. Then again, it could be used legitimately, but it might. And that makes him a hacker.
But wouldn't that mean that, like, Dell or Toshiba are Toshiba's liable then for what I do with my laptop?
Well, that's an interesting question.
Like, if I have a Toshiba laptop, if I were to take this laptop and hack into something, I couldn't have done it without Toshiba. They provided me with what I needed to do it. I mean, isn't that kind of what they're saying?
Kind of. And the thing that our lawyer says is this is incredibly expansive, totally unprecedented, and that it opens up a crack in the door for all kinds of expansion of government intrusion. But also, if you're a website host, and you got to police your site if you think you're up for criminal charges. Now, right now, they're protected. They're immune in a civil case. If Ross were being taken to court by a person instead of by the government in a criminal case, he would be immune for the exact same conduct they're alleging, which is a big gap there, and our lawyer says is arbitrary and disproportionate. But he's also saying is, okay, right now they're protected, but with a precedent set in this case, and look what they're doing with FedEx, this can put a crack in the door for them to use it as a precedent to go after people. What will happen to internet commerce in that case?
We're done.
If I was starting out, I'd be like, it's one thing to risk my money. It's another thing to risk my freedom. And that's what the Forbes article is saying as well. They're saying... Eric Goldman was saying that, it's going to put a chill on the internet.
Well, it's interesting, too, to point out the differences between the way that the government works and the way that the private sector works. So if I was just a person trying to sue Ross for the same things the government is doing, I wouldn't be able to. But for some reason, the government's allowed to. But I tell you what, Lyn, we have to step away for just a moment. The Angel Clark Show will return. Make sure you go to the website, freeross.org.
Hey, phrasing totally epic.
This is the Angel Clark Show.
Be a part of Angel's Army.
Yes! Oh, my God!
Do you think gold is money? No.
No.
Why do central banks hold it?
Well, it's a form of reserves.
So why don't they hold diamonds?
Well, lost tradition.
Welcome back to the Angel Clark Show. It is Thursday. That means it is the Liberty Train. Choo-choo! I have on the line with me Lyn Ulbricht, and you can go to the website freeross.org. There you will find information about her son, Ross. Ross is in a cage. He has been accused by the government of being the founder of the Silk Road. And you all know what the Silk Road is. I'm sure that you do because we've talked about it on this show time and time again. But just in case, the Silk Road is a deep web website. And I am not exactly one of those tech-savvy people, so I can't actually use the Silk Road because I can't figure out how to make the deep web work on my computer. So, but this website, the Silk Road, is basically a... It's like an eBay, but where you could sell whatever you wanted, except for things that are meant to harm people, such as child pornography or assassinations. You could not sell those things. So Ross has been accused of being the creator of the Silk Road, and this, for some strange reason, has led to him being in a cage. FreeRoss.org is the website. There is a YouTube channel, Free Ross. There is a Twitter. The Twitter handle is Free_Ross. And there's a Free Ross Facebook fan page. So, Lyn, I want to thank you for sticking around. Before we get back into the case itself, I have to ask. I know that there have been things that have been sold on websites like eBay. Like, I use eBay myself, and I use Amazon, and I know that there are things that have been sold on eBay and Amazon that are against the law in certain places. And if Ross ends up having these charges stick and is found guilty, does this mean that the founder of eBay should start being afraid?
Well, our lawyer says the precedent will be set with this. And the precedent will be that, or could be, that website hosts are held responsible and criminally liable for what occurs on their site.
So, like, and, if I've got a ton of websites, right? And most of my websites are news websites. So let's say I have, one of my websites and someone makes a comment on that website. And on that comment, they threaten someone else. Right. So they threaten another commenter and that other commenter decides they have a problem with that. Would I then be held liable for that person for threatening?
Well, that's a really good question. Paul Joseph Watson brought that up. He said, so what about hate speech? That's a crime. Does that mean that comments and things like that, could the host be held responsible for that? The author of the Forbes article that came out that was saying that it was going to cast a chill, it was going to hurt online commerce. He says, a lot of websites, they aren't that thorough in policing their sites, and they know that some things are legitimate and some things aren't, and it's kind of somewhat laissez-faire. And that would probably, out of this case, change to where websites would be policed out of self-defense. And then what does that do to free speech? What does that do to... kind of an open, free-willing marketplace that we all benefit from.
Yeah.
He thinks that we'll have heard it.
And, oh, absolutely.
And, of course, it's a big part of our economy. So if it starts putting, a crimp on that, then it's the economy as well. So.
Yes. But when we talk about the economy, there's the internet economy, and then there's the economy that's the corporate economy, where the politicians get the money from the corporations, and they have a problem with the fact that, say, so many people are buying things online, because then their brick-and-mortar stores are kind of pointless. Mm-hmm. So it's right now there's a big battle that's going on between large internet resellers and wholesalers and between brick and mortar stores. So without the economy, we would be in, we'd have a much greater depression than we have right now. But of course, these large companies, they dislike the fact that they have to fight the internet for sales. I mean, Amazon is, they can get, you can buy something on Amazon, and depending on where you live, they can have your purchase delivered to you in like 4 hours. So this is something that a lot of brick and mortar companies, they cannot compete with that. Best Buy can't compete with that. Are you kidding me? So these companies spend a lot of money giving to politicians so that they can fight companies that do things online because, well, they don't like the competition, basically. So Ross is, he was arraigned in New York on 4 different counts. What are the 4 counts that he was arraigned on?
Well, the first one is narcotics trafficking. Well, it's the conspiracy to do that. And the point that they're making is that they're not alleging he ever possessed narcotics or sold them or agreed with anybody to actually sell them. But that just by the fact that he provided this platform, that he conspired, he was part of a conspiracy. And they use the word conspiracy to cast a very wide net. And again, the Forbes article touches on that, where so back in when eBay started in the mid-90s and people were selling fake Pez dispensers on there and defrauding people, does that mean eBay was in conspiracy with them? By this reasoning, yes, it does. So it's a conspiracy to traffic narcotics is one. The second one, which is really is amazing, is the continuing criminal enterprise or the kingpin charge, which is normally attributed to drug cartel people, leaders, and
like the mafia, right?
Yeah.
So they're basically saying that he's a mafia kingpin.
Well, they're saying he's a kingpin, and that's who it's been reserved for in the past.
Wow.
And this is and the way they describe kingpin, you'd think they were talking about a website host.
Well,
you know, managers, and, you know, just, I don't know, just, it's, they're really stretching it.
Well, let's
because
consider.
Because really, they don't have the laws. They don't really have the laws to address what they're trying to allege, because it's all new. It's all virtual, you know, digital. It's cyber activity.
Well, when I think
and
of a mafia kingpin,
that, you know,
Lynn, when I think of a mafia kingpin, I think of someone who has been standing there and who has been giving orders and telling people what to do, and someone who has blood on their hands, literally. And that does not apply to the Silk Road. But we have to step away for just a moment. The Angel Clark Show will return. More with Lynn. Check out the website, freeross.org.
But we see liberty under threat. We see sovereignty under threat. We must respond.
This is the Angel Clark Show.
Work hard and save money. Why the hell would you work for money when they're printing it? Do you know how stupid that is? Your job is to print your own money. It's time to take control of your life. No, don't be paid slaves anymore.
Get off the rat wheel. This is the Angel Clark Show.
Welcome back to the Angel Clark Show. I am speaking with Lyn Ulbricht, who is the mother of Ross. FreeRoss.org is the website. And Ross has been accused of creating and operating the anonymous online marketplace, the Silk Road, under the pseudonym Dread Pirate Roberts. And Ross right now is sitting in a cage. And he has these charges pressed against him, and we've been going through the charges that are pressed against him right now. And we've discussed the engaging in a criminal enterprise. And this one just, I want to get back to this for just a moment. Lynn, I want to thank you so much for sticking around. While no one else could hear us, we were talking about this. And we mentioned it like this. So let's say that someone goes on eBay and they decide they're going to sell tickets to a baseball game, right? Baseball's going on right now. It's the season. So they're selling tickets to a Phillies game. I know no one actually wants to see the Phillies play, but someone out there might actually buy some Phillies tickets, right? So someone goes on to eBay and they see these Phillies tickets and they're like, man, these are good seats. And you know what? Wow, they're cheaper than I thought they were. All right, I'm going to get these tickets. So then this person, they buy their tickets. They use eBay to get the tickets. They pay for them using PayPal or whatever. And then this person, they get their tickets in the mail. USPS drops it off. And the person goes to the baseball stadium. And they go to hand their tickets in to the ticket holder. And the ticket collector says, these are fake. You can't get in with these tickets. What the hell is wrong with you? So then the person says, I bought fake tickets. I'm out like $200 for these stupid fake tickets and the gas to get to this place. And I missed this game. I could have caught this home run ball. Obviously not hit by the Phillies because the Phillies aren't going to be hitting any home runs. But but look, I grew up near Philly. I can say that. So this person gets upset. And they say, you know what? eBay is responsible for this. I am going to go after the seller of those tickets. eBay felicitated that sale. If it weren't for eBay, I would never have been able to get those tickets. eBay is responsible. If it weren't for PayPal, I wouldn't have been able to pay for those tickets. PayPal is responsible. If it weren't for USPS, I wouldn't have been able to get those tickets. USPS is responsible. And every one of those companies, and USPS, of course, being the government company, so ha-ha, they would never be responsible for anything that they do. But every one of those companies, if they are able to stick these charges onto Ross, then every single one of these companies could then also potentially be held liable for conspiracy and running a kingpin, being a kingpin in a criminal enterprise for something that someone sold on their website.
Well,
that's it, right?
By the logic, well, the logic is there. And if the precedent is set, that's what precedent is. You know, the courts refer back to decisions made in other courts.
So there has basically never been anything that has... that has happened on this scale. There's never been any kind of situation where the creator of a website has been held responsible for the things sold on that website, like eBay being there's never been anything like this. So if they are able to stick these charges against Ross, what this means is that for every other website out there that has these platforms, it could affect every single one of them and every person that uses these websites.
Yeah, I mean, as I said before, if it were an individual, like if you were taking Ross to civil court, they do have immunity under Congress passed, I'm going blank, the Consumer Decency Act or Computer Decency Act or something. But anyway, it's there, and it protects them in a civil court. But in criminal court, there's this huge gap where the same conduct, you can go to jail for life. And the government goes, well, don't worry, that's not a problem because you can trust us not to abuse the system. I'm like, hello? That's not how things work. And they also say very ominously in their papers, in their response to the motions, our laws are expansive and adaptable, especially when it comes to the Internet. And this is in direct opposition to the Constitution that says laws are not to be expanded, that they are very specific. But this is what they're doing. They're even saying it. I mean, I'm taking them at their word.
Lynn,
they are saying their laws are expansive and they can go ahead and adapt whatever they have to, you know, whatever they want, basically.
Your first mistake here is expecting the government to follow its own rules and its own constitution. because they don't do that. That's like expecting police to follow their own laws. It doesn't work that way. When they see someone else speeding and they feel like pulling them over, they make an illegal U-turn, putting people's lives at risk. They turn on their sirens. They drive 90 miles an hour in a 45 mile an hour zone. They use no blinkers so that they can pull someone over. So they break the law so that they can give someone a ticket for going 10 miles over. And they do it every day. They do it every single day. The government does not follow its own rules and laws. And what they're doing with Ross is they're setting the precedent so that they can make more and more laws, because essentially they want us to have to give them more money. They want us to not be able to do as many things and to have to give them more money on a regular basis. When the government becomes as large and bloated as it is now, they need to come up with new ways to make money, because we're like $20 trillion in debt right now, and they don't have enough money for all of this. So if we just make more laws that people can break, and then we can take $5,000 here and $20,000 there and $300 there, it all adds up. And the average person can't sit back and fight it, you know? So
no, it's very difficult to fight it.
Government.
Another thing, Paul Joseph Watson made the point. He said this is the biggest threat to the future of the internet since SOPA and PIPA. And those were stopped. And then he called this like the Trojan horse, that they're coming in the back door with this one. They're not passing laws in Congress that do a frontal attack on the internet. They're coming through the back door. And this could happen. I mean,
what we saw is when they first pressed these charges against Ross, they started talking about this murder for hire allegation.
Right.
And they started trying to paint Ross in this light where he was this horrible person that tried to have someone killed. What's going on with that murder for hire allegation?
Well, and let me just say that if you knew Ross, and I hope you will get to meet Ross when he's free, he is the last person in the world that you would ever do that, ever. He's peaceful and loves people and would never in a million years do that. He and I know I'm his mother, but we have tons of testimonials from friends as well saying that.
Yeah. I tell you what, Lyn, hold on to that thought for just a moment. We have to step away. When the Angel Clark show returns, we will find out what is going on with this murder for hire allegation. Make sure you go to the website, freeross.org.
For all those looking to kick the habit of mommy and daddy governments, is the Angel Clark show.
The only thing that's silly is the power of the people's vote. And I think the people should use it to vote for What I'm saying is, I think only an idiot would vote for me. I think the people should keep their money. They're going to need it after this election.
I never wear a suit and a tie.
Never. I mean, these are just things that politicians use to trick you into thinking that they're respectable. I'm here to buy your vote. Buy your vote.
Welcome back to the Angel Clark Show. This is it, folks. This is the final segment of the show this evening. And just because I am about to stop talking doesn't mean that you have to stop listening. You can head to angelclark.us. There you will find 3 years worth of archives of the show. You can download them, stream them, share them with your friends on Facebook, on Twitter, on Tumblr, on LinkedIn, and it's all free today. Also, as usual, I didn't get to share all the news stories that I wanted to with you today. Head to my website, noarmycanstopanidea.com. There you'll find the news stories you need to know about. And I have sticking with me Lyn Ulbricht. You can go to freeross.org. Her son, Ross, has been accused of being the creator and operator of the Silk Road under the pseudonym Dread Pirate Roberts. And Ross right now is in a cage, and he is facing a lot of charges, and these charges are very, very intimidating. Lyn, I want to thank you for sticking around. I need to take a moment to mention that My mom has a lot of fear when it comes to me because of what I do for a living, because I'm very vocal, because I speak out, because I go to a lot of protests where I engage in civil disobedience. And there are numerous times when she has said to me, as I'm, you know, we stop by her place on the way to a protest and we leave, you know, we've got little sandwiches. She packed us for the drive there. And she says, now don't get arrested. Well, Mom, I can't promise that, but I can promise if I do get arrested, you'll be my second call. Obviously, my attorney is my first call. So, but my mom ends up in situations where I think she's worried about me time and time again. And you, Lyn, are in a situation where your son has been accused of many things. He's been thrown in a cage, and here you are, and you're not sitting back and just taking it. You are talking to complete strangers. You are learning about Bitcoin. You're learning about the Silk Road. You're learning about law and these charges, and you're learning all of these things because you're not just going to sit back and let this happen. And I see you fighting. And I think it's great that you're not just sitting back and letting this happen. And I also think that it's worth mentioning, I think it's very important that everyone knows that you are not a kingpin, and you don't have a bunch of Bitcoin. You don't have a stash of thousands of Bitcoin sitting in your pocket that you can rely on to help you fight these charges.
That is accurate. We are not wealthy. We have less money than before this happened. A lot.
I'm
less.
Sure. I'm and, absolutely sure.
And it's our lawyers are being very patient and flexible, but they're doing a mountain of work, and we really need help. We need help to pay them, forensic people, and to get Ross the best defense we can, and to fight this case for everyone. And, you know, as I think I did before, it's a personal battle, yes, for my son, but it's become bigger than that for me. It's become a very important issue for freedom and government overreach. It's just too much. And I feel like I've been put in this situation, and it's my duty to make that point.
You know, on the website freeross.org, it says, and I quote, "This case represents the first challenge to the government's attempt to expand the money laundering statute to include digital currency." Now, so many of my listeners got involved in Bitcoin very, very early on. And so many of them have Bitcoin and Litecoin and Dogecoin and all these coins, right, that they got into early, early on. And if the government starts kind of slapping down on these, it's going to affect a lot of my listeners. And here's a chance for them to get involved and to help with the fight before the precedent is set.
Exactly. That's true. Yeah, I wish I was one of those people who I don't own a Bitcoin, I never have, unfortunately, but yes, it will.
Hindsight's 2020, Lyn. Hindsight is 2020. I've kicked myself a million times over it. You know what? It does nothing. So, murder for hire. Tell me about the murder for hire allegation, because when they first started talking about Ross, they were like, he tried to have someone killed. And I was like, really? Mm-hmm. That's aggression.
It's funny about that, because they claimed that they used it against for a reason to not grant him bail.
Yes.
And yet 2.5 months after the bail hearing, they did not in New York indict him for one charge. He is not indicted. There's six charges or incidents of murder for hire in the complaints. Five of them are not, he is not indicted for in New York. There's one remaining in Maryland that's just sat there. He hasn't actually been arraigned or anything. It's just there.
Well, they don't have
sure
to.
Why or what. Well, there,
now, but see, they'll leave that there. And then what happens is if they fail in New York, then they'll press the charges against him in Maryland.
Well, good luck proving it, because I know he didn't do it.
I'm sure. I'm not saying that he did.
And, but anyway, I assume that's why they didn't indict him for the five in New York, because they don't have the evidence. They have it in the indictment mentioned as an uncharged crime, which is a new thing to me. under the narcotics trafficking and doesn't require proof. They just mention that he did it, basically.
So,
and it's not an indictment.
So they basically they have this law set up so that they can accuse someone of doing something in front of a jury, but they don't have to have any proof that they did it. So it just makes them look bad.
When I researched it on the internet, it was called a trial tactic. Someone said it's a trial tactic. So that doesn't require proof. Pretty serious charge for not requiring proof. But anyway, they didn't indict him for it, and yet. All over the, you know, the bail hearing, the prosecutor made this big dramatic deal about it. The media reported that, and it was all over the place that Ross did this. And so often, assuming that it's true, and even though it hasn't been proven, without the word alleged or accused, the media, so much of that, so many of them are sort of responsible that way. They've already tried and convicted him.
Yeah.
And yet, then the government doesn't indict him for it and doesn't have to prove it.
It's got to be very, very frustrating for you sitting back and seeing all of this happen. And again,
especially for someone with the caliber of person that Ross is, it's just mind-boggling.
Yes. Well, you know, again, I can't tell you how fantastic it is to see you going out and doing these interviews and talking to people and fighting this fight for Ross, because, you know, I think what happens a lot of times is when he was initially arrested and had these charges pressed against him, there was a big uproar. And then it seems like people just kind of forgot. Like people just, that was last year. That was so long ago. People just kind of forgot. And this is still happening. Ross is in a cage right now.
Yep. And of course, that initial thing, I was in such shock. I couldn't, I was paralyzed with shock.
I'm sure.
You know, we were, so now I feel I can be more effective. It's been an amazingly difficult process, the whole thing, but it's worthwhile on so many levels for me to do what I'm doing. And I appreciate your support and the support of people out there. And we need that support. And, you know, we need donations for the lawyers. We also need ideas, connections, anything. You know, people have written in and said, hey, how can I help you? And they've helped us, you know, with different things. It's so much work.
Well, yeah, sharing a news article about it helps to raise awareness. Yeah. If you don't have money to donate, you can just talk about it and spread the word.
Follow us, you know, all that stuff.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Now, again, the website is freeross.org. You can go to YouTube. The YouTube channel is Free Ross. The Twitter handle, free_Ross. The Facebook fan page, Free Ross. Basically, Google Free Ross and you will find these guys. FreeRoss.org. Please get involved. Get active. I can't stress to you just how important this is. You need to do something here. Call to action, folks. The Angel Clark Show will return tomorrow at 5 p.m. Eastern. Lynn, thank you so much for joining me. Until tomorrow, remember, no army can stop an idea whose time has come.
But we see liberty under threat. We see sovereignty under threat. We must respond.
This is the Angel Clark Show.